Hello and welcome to episode 25 of Nintendo Podcast System with myself, Matthew, and as always I'm joined by Jack and Sam.
Hello!
Hello!
We were supposed to do this yesterday. Today's May 2nd.
2nd of May, yes.
Which is bank holiday, so I think this is the first time we're recording it like in midday and not in the evening, which is weird.
It is a little strange.
But oh well. We were planning on recording yesterday with Stealth, who's this person on Twitter I like his... I don't know about you two, but basically I follow him. And he has really good opinions about Nintendo. Oh, do you? Oh, alright. Yeah.
He followed me, so I followed him back. So.
Alright. I've just seen that like he has good opinions about Nintendo, so, and we're both looking forward to Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem coming out in June, so that's cool.
That's two people.
That's two people. Two people out of the whole of UK and North America combined. Oh, I know, and I think Jesse from Nintendo Dads is looking forward to it, so. Anyway, this will be the last one for a while. We may be able to do something towards the end of May, but for the rest of May, there won't be one because I have exams coming up. Or if Jack and Sam are able to sort something out, we may have an episode, another episode for
you
guys.
We might do something different in the time. Anyway, maybe do some recordings on Sam's channel or something like that. But we'll work something out.
Yeah, we will.
Yeah.
I just want to say, like, good luck to anybody taking exams in the next month or two. Because I am just, like, just screwed in most of them.
You'll like, be fine. Don't panic. Do lots of revision.
So.
And pass with flying colours.
Hopefully. Well, in some of them, I think I'll do alright. But anyway. So, with that, let's move on to our next section.
Ding.
Oh wait, no, hold on. I did like, I know.
Done it again.
I forgot the intro music. I always do this.
Just do Star Fox stuff.
I was planning on doing Star Wolf theme from Star Fox Zero. That's what I was gonna choose.
Yeah, you gotta do that one.
That was really good. Anyway, and with that, let's move on to our next section. So this is our news section right now. In case you've missed it, that's been like Nintendo dropped a bombshell of news last
Kaboom!
Wednesday. Pretty much. The whole community. Basically they talked about they announced stuff regarding NX and the new Zelda. Basically the Nintendo NX will be launching next year in March 2017. The new Zelda will be coming to both NX and Wii U. And Zelda will be the only thing coming to E3, and there will be no NX at E3. So those three topics will be covered in our discussion later on. But for now, there's been a decent amount of news. Let's start off with new amiibo. Specifically, with Splatoon. Calamari had been revealed to be the latest. Figures of amiibo alongside repaints of the original three being the Inkling Boy, Gale and Squid. So it looked like that data filing from I think a couple of months ago that had amiibo idol B and amiibo idol A turned out true. So we are
there
getting new amiibo. Yeah,
I bet all these people that have made their own custom versions of Callie and Marie are really pissed off with it, though.
Oh, but it was like...
All that time spent doing that, and then they're just going to release
like a real
anyway.
One coming out, yeah.
Yeah.
They do look awesome, though. I mean, they got like glitter in the actual dresses, so it looks quite real to what the characters are in the game. So I was like, ooh, they've made them extra special.
Ooh, shiny.
Sparklies.
I think...
I've become a magpie. I just want to steal everything. It's all shiny.
I think if it's one thing people will get them for, it is for the fact that they do look cool. Because like what they unlock in game, it's just something that like I find really not necessarily unnecessary, but basically they allow you to put the plaza as a Splatfest theme when it's all night and the Squid Sisters are dancing on the trucks and stuff. And you make them dance to like different songs like Kanayomari Incantation, I believe. Incantation. I believe that's it. That's the final boss theme. As well as Ink Me Up, which is the theme that plays during battles, during Splatfests. But hopefully it will allow you to unlock new music as well, though. Because I think if they allowed you to unlock new music to play in the actual battles themselves, both Splatfest battles and normal battles, then I'd be happy. Because with Splatfest battles, they just feel a bit repetitive, like hearing the same song over and over again, so I would like something different to hear.
It's nice that
just
you unlock
change up the
something...
pace a bit.
Yeah, nice that you unlock something with it, but it doesn't really change anything gameplay-wise.
Exactly.
As far as we know. I'm just wondering whether they might have like some extra costume sets or something instead.
Hopefully. That'd be cool if you could look like Callie and Marie outfits. That'd be cool.
It looked like there was five songs on the list and some extra dance moves and things as far as I was aware of it, but that other than that they haven't really explained what else you get with it. So
Well, it's not greatly, it's just the fact that they do look cool.
They do look like cool amiibos. So hopefully you can use them for likes of like Mario Maker and things like that, maybe.
I would have thought so.
Well, I think they included like a new song. Like, it's not a cover, it's a brand new song, because they did another live event in Japan at, I believe it's Shokeki, I believe it, the event is called.
Right.
You know, basically it's like a Hatsune Miku theme that was seen a couple of months ago. Do you remember, Jack?
Yeah, like, the actual show with the live project, yeah.
Yeah, so they did the same thing very recently. I think it would have been on Friday, Friday in Japan. And they did a new song, so hopefully that'll allow you to unlock the new song in, like, battles and stuff like that. But I don't know. They look cool. They come out on July 8th, and they'll also be part of a jewel pack, which is pretty cool. So you can get both. And then...
Yay!
Yeah, and then in America, you could get the free repaints as a pack, whereas in Europe you can't. But in Europe, you could get all three separately, whereas in America, the Orange Squid is only exclusive to that free pack, so...
So is it they literally just recolored
I think
the same
so.
Amiibo?
Yeah.
Or...
Which is a bit sad, like,
I like the fact that they've done a different coloured skin for one of them, so it just shows a bit of diversity.
True.
Really.
True.
It does. I'm hoping like they add like Slosher and Splatling weapons, because like with the original trio, the girl would unlock charger challenges, whereas the boy would unlock roller challenges. So I hope these new amiibo will unlock Slosher and Splatling challenges. That'd be cool.
That would be interesting.
Yeah.
What about the paintbrush? Mm-hmm. Paintbrush as well.
Well, that's a roller, isn't it? So.
Kind of.
Yeah.
Anyway. So, who do you prefer, Callie or Marie? Who's your pick?
Oh, no. Don't make me
choose. We'll have to have a Splatfest to decide.
They should totally do that for like the 1 year anniversary. Because that's always been like Callie. Something.
Callie or Marie?
Yeah. I'm Callie. I'm sticking by Callie.
I think I'd go Mari.
I'd let them fight it out between themselves, then I'd choose the winner.
Alright. That's so stupid. Oh well. Let's move on then.
I choose the winning team!
Sorry. Let's move on to the next piece of news. Nintendo and its financial meetings last Wednesday. They announced that Miitomo hits 10 million downloads worldwide, which is massive. You know, that's almost as many Wii U's as sold in the world.
Yeah, it's just a little bit annoying, but
but then again, it's free. So.
Yeah, it's nice. Yeah. It's nice that it's had so many downloads, and that it still seems fairly popular around some areas of the world. But it seems to have just died a death in some parts as well. It's just sort of one of those people download it because it was free and wanted to try it, and then just don't ever play it ever again kind of thing. But.
Yeah, like, I do still have Miitomo, but right now it's more just playing just to get the platinum coins.
I think that's the main sort of selling point of it to any actual Nintendo owners, is getting those coins so you can unlock extra features such as like free games or discounts on games. But if you haven't got any Nintendo consoles and you've just downloaded the app just to try it out, there's not really much else to keep you wanting to play it,
really,
I guess.
Yeah.
Other than unlocking the extra costumes within the game, for instance, like the Splatoon one that's just been put
on there.
And
that's cool.
Little things like
that.
But then,
did that through retweets, didn't we?
Yeah, yeah. And it hit the target, whatever target it was. So, yeah, crazy.
What is it? Yeah, just like Miitomo, I feel that the hype has died down. I remember getting it on the first day, and I was just playing it for ages and ages, just adding people and stuff like that, and answering questions. But right now, it's like, some of the questions can be fun, but at the same time, it just became a bit harder to see other people's answers. Because you know when you go into recent, that little section, you can see the recent replies and stuff like that, the recent people that have liked it and stuff. But but what's annoying is that you can't see like recent answers. It's more like recent activity on other people's answers than anything. And I'm not sure if you could change it to just recent answers.
Not
so
as
I just find
far
it,
as I'm aware.
Yeah, I just find it annoying that it's always
basically you go through people's lists of games and you find a list of answers, and it's just one of the random answers to one of the, like, say 50 questions they've answered. You don't get like the last one they've answered, you just get one of the random lists of them.
Well, it's
in
not
there. So
random,
you
but like it is your friend's answers, but
yeah, it's your friend's answers, but if they've answered 50 questions, you're going to get one of the 50 rather than the most recent question answered kind of thing.
Or like one that's been like really old or something like that, so that's what I find really annoying.
And because you can only basically answer, see three of their questions a day without spending sweets or whatever, it's a little bit annoying, but, you know. It's one of those, it doesn't really matter, I suppose it's just a first sort of test for Nintendo. And using an app, so they're going to have a few like kinks here and there, but it's overall it's been quite fun and interesting to get some really weird answers and really weird questions, and
that's true.
You say it's things you wouldn't normally ask people. It's a nice little experiment, and I like the fact that you can get something for doing it, but like I said, it's not a lot there to keep people wanting to go back every now and then. It's other than maybe unlocking the coins you get for like a daily play kind of thing, or extra game tickets so you can unlock stuff on the drop game. So yeah, it'd be interesting to see what they do with it in the future, definitely. I mean, especially with 10 million people downloaded it.
That's true. But then again, does that number account for people that downloaded it for like about 10 minutes and then deleted it straight afterwards?
It could be, yeah.
Because then that just
so.
Doesn't hold anything, does it? Because with a game, that's something. Because people might have sold it back, fair enough. But the process is like less simple than just simply holding the icon on your home screen and then just clicking the X to delete it.
Yeah.
So
It
But I
means
don't
they
know.
need more of like a retention score of how many people are using it daily rather than
That's true. I'm
the
sure
actual.
they keep an eye on their actual activity and stuff, so
Hopefully.
they've got to be monitoring these things to get that kind of figure anyway.
But there's been lots of things like, oh, we've hit a 10 million downloads. Here you go, have an extra 1,000 coins or whatever in the game. It's like, yeah, thanks for that. And what am I going to do with that? So go and buy another costume and then, okay, it's gone again. But yeah, one of those.
Yeah, so speaking of mobile, they also announced their next mobile games, which are rather Animal Crossing and Fire Emblem, which are two very opposing IPs, in my opinion, to be honest. Because on the one hand, you've got Animal Crossing; it's very popular with like the casual audience as well. That's seen by like New Leaf. New Leaf has sold over 10 million, I think. And then you've also got Fire Emblem, which is far more mature but offers really good strategy RPG gameplay. So they're two
Just
very
no heavy
different.
petting.
Yeah, just saying. But yeah, they're two pretty good franchises to start off with mobile industry. What do you guys think about it?
I have read something on the Animal Crossing one. They have put that they're going to try and do something, so it's a completely different way of playing it than the standard Animal Crossing games. So I'm kind of interested to see what they're going to pull out of the hat for this one.
I think Animal Crossing is probably one of the better franchises they could use for mobile games, just in the way it's set out. I mean, half the games that are on mobile are like the build your own city kind of things, or set up a town or whatever. And Animal Crossing would be perfect for that. You say you talk through with Tom Nook how to build a city. You build your first one. Then you've got to wait like an hour for the next one to be built and things like that. It seems like a perfect setup for it, to be honest. It's
Yeah, I'm hoping it's going to be something like that.
but you can just the thing that makes me laugh is the fact that you probably would have to go back to Tom Nook to basically buy coins off of him, like with real world money. So effectively, he would be the one making money for Nintendo.
No, but
Just. Well,
interesting concept.
but how they're dealing with like at least that concept of like paying real life money to get stuff in Miitomo, at least it's like apparently very hard to even get to that option. It's not all up in your face like other apps, you know.
Yeah, it doesn't force you into it. It's an option within the menu,
So
but you
I do
don't
like
have to
that.
do it.
I do like that approach to them. But I've got the email here. Press email. Nintendo will design Animal Crossing so that it'll be connected with the world of Animal Crossing for dedicated gaming systems. But playing both Animal Crossing games, users will find increased enjoyment. Sorry. Both of these are pure game applications. Compared to Miitomo, they have more prominent game elements. And the game content will tie closely into Nintendo's dedicated game business. So the last part was bringing in both mobile games. But so from the looks of it, Animal Crossing will have some connection with games. I don't know if that will mean a new one for the NX or current ones like with New Leaf or Happy Home Designer. But it should be very interesting to see.
Maybe it just means like take the same style of gameplay, but I don't know
Maybe.
if it will necessarily mean,
But
you
I
know.
think. Oh, go on.
No, sorry, you carry on.
Alright. I think it's just like a good franchise to start with, though. Because it's just very popular to bring with on the go. I prefer. Well, if I did have to choose, I would rather it be on my handheld because I could just bring it with me. Instead of having to go on my console for what is probably going to be about just under an hour session. When I go on my console, I would love it to be more than just an hour, you know.
That's the thing with the mobile games though, because they're quick, like play 10 minutes and go off, do something else, come back
Exactly,
to it later
so
on in the afternoon or something. So
that's a good thing.
it'll work perfectly. But I think we can see how well Animal Crossing would work with it. But what about with Fire Emblem? How do you think they'd work that into a mobile game?
I'm thinking they might do it map based, and then you've got to try and conquer or defeat enemies.
Sort of like the main games then.
Oh,
I think,
yeah.
yeah, I was listening to the Game Explain discussion about this, and they said basically there's like sort of like an overarching story, but it won't be that major or anything, and they'll just focus on the maps. And one of the ideas they had to bring in that free-to-play concept maybe was that when you're because on Fire Emblem, when your teammate dies, they die for good. Or at least in the
Right.
classic games, and then in the more modern games, you either get to play a classic mode, which is permadeath, if your character dies, or if a unit dies, they're gone, like, for the rest of the game. But then there's also a casual mode where they just they're not available to battle for the rest of the map. So
Well, that could be the whole pay to win
yeah,
aspect of it, as
like
you could pay to revive them or something like
well,
that.
no, it's like yeah, like pay to revive them immediately or wait like about another half an hour or whatever to
Just
revive
have
them.
them
Yeah.
revive themselves. That would probably be the greatest way that they'd probably play it, to be honest. But yeah, it's the end of the day, they are going to try and make money out of these games, and that's the only reason to go into the mobile market. It's an easy concept. You only have to make a software for it. You don't have to worry about hardware, so you're already saving yourself a lot of money because you're not making it for specific consoles. You're not having
But then
it's
you've got
all
to remember, you've got to try and
downloads.
cater for a huge market of different processes of
Yeah.
mobiles. So they probably have to test it and look for recommendations and stuff.
Okay, cool.
But
So,
I think a
was there
while back.
anything mentioned on price? Do you know, Matt? I've not seen anything
Yeah, I was
personally.
just about to say this. I think Miitomo was going to be the only free to play game.
Yeah.
I can't remember if DNA, well, DNA partnered with Nintendo to bring these games. I can't remember if they worked on Miitomo and if Miitomo was one of the five games to be launched by March 2017, or at least that was like
I
the original
don't
goal.
think it was, to be
I'm
honest. I
not
think
sure.
Miitomo's just Nintendo, but I'm not
I
sure.
think so,
But,
but DNA will be working with like the rest of them, and I assume Animal Crossing Fire Emblem will be part of that, and so I think it will be pay like to actually get it, which I'm not sure about. If it is, then I think it'd only have to be like about the price of like I think Angry Birds is like £2, Fruit Ninja is about like 69p and stuff like that. I think that's the way they should be going about it, because if they do like £10, that's gonna get people off, because people just look on the app store, they see that something's free and they get it and try it out. Whereas if there's like the paywall right there, it's a big one at that, then that's gonna cause problems. If
I've
that
just looked into Miitomo, and it was made by a joint venture by Nintendo and a company called Nuance.
All right.
Who I've never heard of, so yeah, just to let everyone know.
All right. But yeah, so those are both releasing by this fall. I'm not sure, but like around when? I'm hoping like about sometime in September. That would be good time, I think, 6 months after Miitomo.
Yeah, I think it's a good cool down time.
That'd be true. So I'm hoping to see more info at the next investor meeting, which will be in about 3 months' time, it should be. Yes, that's good. Moving on then, our next piece of news is just that in a couple of days, or may have came out depending on when I get this episode done and ready, Kurokuro will have revealed new information regarding Pokemon Sun and Moon, which is very exciting.
Oh,
Oh, because it's
do it
been
now already.
because like the legendary names were apparently trademarked by Game Freak, weren't they? I think it was like Solar Leo or something, and or Luna Leo and something, I don't know, but Solar and Leo. No, Solar and
Mm.
Luna.
Luna.
Definitely, yeah. Sol and Luna were definitely key words, which of course tie into like Sun and Moon.
See how that goes.
So I think we touched it on this either a couple of podcasts ago or whatever, but I think we could be seeing the legendaries. I think box art as well, because if we get the legendaries, I think we could be seeing the box art as well. And then maybe the region of the map of the region and maybe the starters. I think those are the three things that they need to reveal. And I think we could.
I think.
I did watch an interesting video by the Guardian Goomba. I don't know if you ever watched any of his videos.
Oh, from Game Theory.
From Game Theory, yeah. He basically is saying that he reckons that it will go back to Japan this time, because the whole Sun and Moon is based on two gods in Japanese like mythic culture.
All
Because it
right.
follows on from, it's sort of linked to gold and silver with like Ho-Oh and, oh, what's the other one called? I can't remember.
Lugia.
Lugia, because
Well, that
it's sort
was.
of linked with them too.
Oh, okay. I think it's just like.
So.
I think with Ho-Oh and Lugia, I thought it was like to do with heart and soul. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
It was, yeah.
But with. No, because we were
It
all
was a.
thinking, judging by that one hotel scene or whatever from that concept art, I think we could be seeing like a more tropical setting, which would be cool. I'm hoping not Hoenn like, because I didn't really like Hoenn that much. To be honest, it was all right, but just wasn't a big fan of it.
Well, there's plenty of other places they could use it in terms of location, but yeah, it's we'll soon find out in the next few days or maybe or in coming months. So,
Hopefully, but it's gonna be very exciting.
yeah, woo!
And speaking of teasers, I just want to do this quickly. So, hold on, I'll get up.
Well, you find that Xenoblade Chronicles has also just been added to the American Wii U shop, eShop. So if anyone was interested in downloading that for their to play on the pad and stuff, it's there. Go do it. Carry on.
Do it now.
Do it. Do it. I've still not picked it up, to be honest, Xenoblade Chronicles. I might have to have a look into that in the next couple of weeks. Yeah.
Amongst all the other games you've got from the
Yeah.
Humble Bundle.
Oh yeah, I forgot to mention that. Yeah, I'll dig more into that in our next section. But the Humble Bundle is basically Nintendo based this month. We've got Wii U games and 3DS games. And I know Freedom Planet was one of the games in there, so I'm quite happy that so many people have bought it and get to experience that game. It's so good, so good.
Yeah,
That and Shun.
I enjoyed it. I must admit, it does make you think a little more than a normal like Sonic game. I mean, I've done a few videos on it. I think it was pretty good for someone who has never played, wasn't sure about it.
Matt, are you there or
Yeah, sorry, I was just
have you found it?
getting this. Yeah, so basically, a couple of months ago, the CEO of Level 5, Akihiro Hino, was teasing that there'd be another sequel in a popular franchise that didn't get one before. And same guy teases yet again this upcoming game. And it's very likely, which pleases me to endless degree, a new Inazuma 11 game, which is awesome. So for those of you that don't know, I love Inazuma 11. It's one of my favourite franchises, at least
I'm
on
sure you've touched upon
handheld.
that a couple of times in
I
previous
think so.
episodes.
I may have hinted at it at the least, but
Maybe at least like six, seven times in previous episodes, I think. So.
Yeah, so basically, he put it out a couple of months ago that at Level 5 Vision 2016, that they're working on a number of new anime and games. And there'll also be that new title, and it starts with. And he just did the first letter, which was I. Of course, this was in Japanese, but the first character, I believe it's Kanji, for that name was also the first character of the Japanese name for Inazuma 11. So that was the first hint that it will be Inazuma 11. But just recently, on the day of recording, so I'm very happy we did delay it. He tweeted out a picture of a character that looks like he comes from Inazuma 11. He's got like a sport kit. He has a sport kit on. The team says Kirastar. But yeah, he looks cool. But he certainly looks like he's from Inazuma 11. And then he followed up saying, "We're returning to the game's origin this time. It's completely straight up. Hot-blooded. No avatars or time limits. It's nothing to laugh about. Seriously, lol. There'll be new challenges, and I think you'll be surprised. Look forward to it. Oh, and also, I think it goes without saying, this isn't a Pro League story." So, I really don't know what it means by that. So, because in Go, they added, like, a bunch of new mechanics and stuff. They added the avatars. In Chrono Stones, they added the avatar, Avatar Armed, the Armify avatars, and also the Mixi Max, and then in Galaxy, which hopefully will be releasing over here in Europe this year, they added Souls, which basically allows you to turn into animals, so that's fun. So hopefully, judging from this, they're returning to like just pure, just techniques, which. It's pretty exciting, because even though all the new stuff in the Go games are really cool, they seem like a bit overpowered and make it a bit too easy, so it's good to see them returning back to basics. I don't know how it will line up in the world. It may be in a completely different world, I don't know. But I just wanted to say quickly, it may not be quickly, but I just wanted to say, because it's Inazuma 11, so...
Are you happy?
I am happy. Hopefully.
He's ecstatic.
I'm ecstatic. It probably won't come out for like about 3 years until here, and until it comes out here. But hopefully it'll be coming out soon in Japan so we could get the anime. So, but yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I hope it's really cool. And with that wraps up for the news section, so let's move on to the next section. So this is our what have we been playing section right now. Which one of you two want to start off then? It's been a good amount.
I don't mind.
Go on, Jack, you first.
Yeah,
you
Jack,
first.
You can go first, yeah.
Okay. I've got so many games I've been playing this last, like, well, couple of weeks or so. As mentioned before, the last episode, I got Bayonetta 2.
Yeah.
I played for another couple levels of that, and it was it's been pretty good. I'm still, it's an improving game from what I thought about it last time. I'm definitely going to carry on playing through it, but I also got several other games. I got Star Fox Guard and Star Fox Zero, which I have absolutely loved. Both of them, they're so good. Everyone's still complaining about controls, or there's so many people on like Twitter and Facebook that have been going, "Oh, I played Star Fox Zero, I completed it, and now I'm going to give it and trade it in." And I'm just like, so you've played for it once, and now you're going to go trade it in. You've obviously never played a Star Fox game before.
There's different routes, isn't there, or different
every level
points you could take a different.
Yeah, Every level that says mission complete has a different path to completing the level. Because they should say mission accomplished.
Oh yeah, they
And
do that, don't they, in 64?
yeah, mission accomplished is to unlock, go through to the your final, your better route. So I've only played through it once myself, and I think I've of the levels I've been through, there's been six levels I did mission complete, and one was mission accomplished. So I'm definitely gonna go back through and look for all the hidden areas. I think I've sort of grasped where some of them are. A lot of it depends on how quickly you finish the level and collecting certain medals and things like that. But yeah, I found it enjoyable. I've not really had many problems with controls wise. I think it's a bit fiddly when you're switching from the actual lilac wing to the walker, which looks just like a llama to me, the llama walker.
Llama.
Looks more like a chicken.
Chicken?
Yeah, don't you
Maybe.
see it?
Chicken. Maybe a
Yeah,
little
with
bit.
its
Yeah.
little wings.
It's like a chicken llama giraffe. We'll call it that. So,
Chicken llama giraffe.
but that is quite fiddly to control, and I can, if that's what people are moaning about, I can sort of see it. But using the normal like flying controls, I've had no problems whatsoever with it. I think it's fine. Yeah, so pretty cool. I'm just on to the final boss, so I don't want to spoil it for anyone who hasn't like beaten it yet. So I won't talk much about that.
All right. It's not only
In
look. Oh,
terms,
go on.
sorry.
I was just about to say that it really does look fun, like an arcade shooter, so.
Yeah, it's if that's what you take it as, like a quick arcade shooter. Yeah, it's really good fun. Some of the levels may be a little bit shorter than original, like the original sort of Star Fox, but the amount of stuff they pack into it, I think it's worth it. What they've done to it. It's, I mean, there's the only issue, other issue I've sort of come across with it is some of the levels with the bigger ships you have to attack. When explosions and things go off, it just makes the game go run slower and like it loses
All right.
frames and things, which is rather annoying, but it's not enough to say you can't play the game. It's impossible to play. It only happens for a few seconds at most, and you can still play through it. It's not a problem.
All right.
Yeah,
So,
so
how
Star
are you
Fox Zero, pretty
finding?
good.
All right, hopefully I'll be able to get it for my birthday later on in the year. So, how are you finding Guard then as well?
Guard I got before Star Fox Zero. I pre-ordered both at the same time and got Guard the day before. What was really annoying is I got the case, and the case was a download code only, so it gave me a download code within the case. And I was like, well, what was the point of that? You could have just sent me the code on an email or something, you know? It was like, well, that was really weird. But
Data protection, I guess. Well, that's a good point.
possibly, but it still seems rather strange that you've got a download code. Surely you wouldn't want to send the case because that would save money by not sending
That's true.
cases, you know?
And maybe it's just the
Seems
fact of
very.
like having a case, really.
But then I did find out the edition with the metal case of Star Fox Zero and Guard
First print
did have
edition.
a did have a CD for Star Fox Guard.
Don't know why
So
they.
I'm like, yeah, it's very odd. I don't know if it was a decision they've gone back on or something, but it's very odd.
It's very odd.
Anyway, the game, yeah, pretty fun. It's quite a hard one to describe, so I'll try my best. You basically have a base, and you have 10 cameras with mounted like guns on these cameras on this base. You've got a little mining platform in the middle, which you've got to protect. And from this little base, you have maybe four or five open sections, and enemy robots get transported in, and they move into your base and try and destroy the main mining platform in the middle. They've all the robots have got different ways they attack. They either attack run in and attack your main base directly, or they'll attack your cameras and disable them so you can't use them. The whole thing of it is there's 10 to 12 cameras on each base, and you can switch between each camera on your Wii U pad. So you've got to use the screen and look at each camera, depending where enemy robots are. You've got to click one camera, and you can shoot from the one camera. You can only shoot at one camera at a time. It's really quite an interesting concept. It's not really one of the games I would normally choose to play, but I gave it a quick go, and it was quite fun. It was quite frantic, and from the what I've heard, you can make your own levels for friends to play. So I might try that in the future, and make a few and send them to a few people just to annoy them. But yeah, it's for a quick pick me up. It's pretty good. It's pretty decent. I mean, I don't know how long again it's going to last to play. There are quite a lot of levels within the game. I think over 90 to 100 levels. So it's got its own amount of playability, but it's not overly challenging until it gets to like the last minute or so. Then the robots, when you've only got so many robots left, they'll speed up and go a bit quicker, and you've got to try and find them all while trying to use the cameras which aren't blocked off, kind of thing. So it is difficult to explain it without visual displays, but yeah, it's worth a look. It's a good game. Worth definitely worth a cheap pickup if you can grab hold of it. So yeah, other than that, I think we went to well, I went to Street Pass Basingstoke with some other people the other day. We played Monster Hunter and their Pokken as a tournament there. I've played one game of Pokken and failed miserably. And Ant, who we've had on the podcast before, was nice enough to record my awful play of Pokken. So you
Oh,
might be able to see that in the future.
yes.
I'll share it to the page and
Oh, please do.
see how badly I play at
I
Pokken.
really want to
So
see that now.
yeah.
But you
Yeah,
had fun though, you had
it was
fun.
a really good day. I got up a few levels on Monster Hunter. Went up to HR7 now, so slowly moving up the charts.
I need to get back
Woo,
into that.
HR7.
Yeah, woo.
I need to get back to playing that in a bit, probably after exams, maybe. I don't know, but
Maybe we should start playing that a bit more in the future.
I'm just not the greatest Monster Hunter fan, sadly. That would probably
We
like
can teach it to you.
all right, but if I
It's
don't.
definitely a grindy experience with Monster Hunter. You've got to really go in and play quite a lot of, well, fight against a lot of monsters until you can actually get into the proper higher levels and
Fair
understand
enough.
what the hell's going on, you know? So
Yeah, but in some ways, I really want to say that I don't like it, just so I could probably piss off the whole Street Pass UK community. Oh,
Oh
because
dear.
like, because everybody in there is like crazy for it, like, aren't they?
All opinions mentioned in this podcast
but
are not mine.
I certainly want to have it give another go. Speaking of giving stuff another go, Jack, how are you finding Bayonetta 2?
I already said that one. I said, yeah, it was all right. It was good.
Oh, okay.
So
Sorry.
I said at the start, yeah, you missed that. Oh, what are you doing? Pay attention.
Sorry.
Dear, oh
Well, I
dear.
thought there was going to be a bit more. Like.
No, I've only played it for a few levels of it, and
Oh,
it was
right.
just pretty fun still. But I say I need to play a bit more of it. But the fact is,
Fair enough.
because I got the Humble Bundle, and there was four Wii U games, four 3DS games, and a theme, and there's even more to come on Tuesday.
Oh, on
So
Tuesday.
I've been playing, yeah, Tuesday. So Freedom Planet Shantae were two of the big ones on there. Definitely worth picking up. So if you haven't seen it, go and check out Sam's videos of it. They're really good. But I've also been playing Affordable Space Adventures.
Oh, I haven't tried that one yet.
No, it was in a Nintendo Direct, I think last summer, the last time I
It's
remember.
got very high praise for its use of gamepad stuff, I think.
Yeah, it's a really good game actually. The basis of it is you're this company advertises for a trip away to a planet away from Earth on this little spaceship, And it says whatever you can go on this uncharted world, and wherever you find, you can keep it as your own, as your own part of land, if you like, claim it as your own. It all goes horribly wrong, as most of these like space trips always do, and basically you're the last ship left on the planet, and you've got to go through each section to find one of the distress speaker balloons, which are they scattered along the planet as part of their thing they do when they launch people away. Unfortunately, the first two I've found, neither of them were working, so it's like pain. But the whole game is a basis of like a puzzle ship platformer kind of thing. It's weird to describe again, but you've basically got all the controls on your gamepad. You've got like engine, you've got likes of anti-gravity, and basically there's three different types of things on each engine. So you've got electricity, you've got heat, and the other one was sound. So you've got three different little charts to tell you how much of those you're using, and you come up across these artifacts, enemy kind of things, and each one of them can either detect sound, detect heat, or detect electricity. So you've got to adjust your ship depending on what that enemy doesn't want. So if he's got a high sound, you go near him with a big speaker going off, then he's going to attack you and kill you, kind of thing. So you've got to change all your settings before you find the enemy to go through and sneak through to the next section, kind of thing. But it is rather complicated, and at the same time really fun. It's
okay.
As you go further onto each level, you unlock an extra part for your ship that repairs itself. And so far, I think I'm up to about 9 parts of 20 altogether. So it's got a real interesting little concept to it, and it's really challenging, but it can get too difficult at some parts, I think. You've really got to overthink. So it's one of those, if you're into those sort of puzzling games, the best way I can sort of describe it is you have like Abe's Odyssey. It's quite kind of similar to that sort of game style.
Oh, okay.
As in, got to solve the puzzle to continue, kind of thing. But other than that, there's nothing else I could really like sort of say it's similar to.
Okay.
It's very unique. So. But yeah, well worth a look if you've picked up the bundle, along with Freedom Planet Shantae and a few others in there. So, cool.
Mm.
So I've been talking for ages, so I'll pass on to whoever wants to talk.
Who should it be then? The decider.
it's fine, you go for it.
Alright. So I also picked up the Humble Bundle. Just as a question, even if you picked up the maximum, which was about $13, I think, will you be able to get the games that come out on Tuesday then as well? Or...
Yes.
Oh, okay. Just want to ask.
If you pay the maximum, you will definitely get the games on Tuesday.
Okay.
But if you've only paid for the smaller bundle, I don't think you get it. I think it's only like the medium and the larger bundle you get them.
Okay. But yeah, I downloaded Citizens of Earth, Street Fighter 4 3D, and Retro City Rampage DX on my 3DS. Street Fighter, I quite liked. I just went through the classic arcade mode, whatever, with Cammy, first of all. I quite like it. Yeah. There's no tutorial like in Pokken.
No.
So I'm not really sure what to do exactly.
It was one of the first games on the Street Fighter game, if I remember.
Street Fighter was at launch, Street Fighter was at launch. It looks decent, to be fair. Like, I'm not really noticing any frame rate drops or whatever, but...
I've heard good things of the 3DS version. I don't know how well it plays against other people.
Hold on.
But... hold it on.
I can hear mumbling.
I can as well. Yeah. Hopefully he doesn't keep this part in the podcast, otherwise it'll be really weird.
I'm sure he'll cut it out.
If he doesn't, we're going to put this like secret password in, like, I don't know.
Right, I'm back, sorry. Oh. I'll just cut that out. What was I talking about?
Yeah, we thought you might.
You were talking about Street Fighter.
Yeah, Street Fighter. I quite like it. It's quite fun. I haven't played any of it since I'm getting it on Wednesday or whenever it was. But other than that, I haven't played Citizens of Earth, but I did play Retro City Rampage for a while. From the looks of it, because I've seen that the old GTA stuff, when it's just a top-down view, that was how it was at first. That's basically Retro City Rampage, I think, from the looks of it, but it's got like a lot of 80s references and stuff. Like, there's the A-Team, you meet the A-Team, and they beat you up, I think.
You meet the A-Team?
Yeah, but they're not the A-Team, they're like the T-Team or whatever.
The B-Team?
I don't know. And then you, and there's one part where you need to go to this area on the streets. You just see the Ninja Turtles come out of nowhere. Yeah, like, they don't speak or anything like that. They just, like, appear and you beat them up. And when you beat all of them, the achievement comes up and it says Killer Bunker. So, and then, and one of the features you could do is change the radio station. And, I forgot what exactly it was called, but basically it was, like Mega Man's 2 title theme. When,
right.
You know, I can't remember it exactly, but it starts off like da 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 or something like that. Sorry, like, I'm terrible at that kind of stuff, but, you know, in that scene of Mega Man 2, the title theme basically.
Oh, right, yeah.
When it starts at the bottom of that skyscraper and then it goes to the top, scrolls to the top, and then there's Mega Man there. That scene was in the game.
Okay.
And then, like, he just gets shot, and then he falls to the ground, and then the Duck Hunt dog appears. So there's like a lot of like 80s and retro references, and then there's Doc Martin as well. I can't forget his name, but instead of Great Scott, he goes Good Gosh. So there's just like a lot of like weird references in there. Well, from at least my point of view, but they're cool. Like I can appreciate that. Because I'm not from that time, but yeah, I can still appreciate all of those references and stuff like that. So that's really cool. But yeah, it's quite fun. I need to get back to it. Yeah, it's alright. It can be quite fun, but I can see it getting quite repetitive quite quickly. But time will tell. Also part of the Humble Bundle. I downloaded, because I don't have much space, I downloaded Affordable Space Adventures, which I need to try soon. I also got Freedom Planet, which I've played a good bit, so I can finally play that. And I'm quite liking it. It's quite good. I'm quite liking it. The voice acting, I didn't expect that to be voice acting. It's like mix and match, not mix and match, but like just
some
like
it's a bit cringy.
Oh, it's definitely cringy, but like just some how they record it seems a bit on and off. I don't know. But for the most part,
this is the thing with that game though. You can play it through adventure mode and suffer through all the the voice acting, or you can play it through classic and just ignores all the cutscenes. So.
Like I have to see the story first. I feel like.
Oh, okay. I think that's good though. So if you play through it once, see all the story, and you don't really need to see it again. So you just go back and play through classic and just play through the levels. So.
Pretty much. But I'm liking the gameplay. It's good. That's all I can say about it. Really, it's basically like Sonic, but a bit more variety. In some ways, I'm just liking it. I'm really liking it. I can't really say much. I'm sorry.
It's alright, you can play for a bit more, you can tell me how good it is later on.
Yeah, I'm where am I? I think at the fourth level, maybe. Yeah,
Fourth
I
floor.
just beat the Fortune level, Fortune Street or whatever, that level.
Oh, that one.
Yeah, I think that's what I finished up to,
Quite
yeah.
fun.
But yes, it's a pretty
Did
good
you
game.
find the little Easter egg in the Fortune Street area?
I'm not sure what you're talking about, sorry.
There's an area with some disco balls, and you
Oh, I
should
saw
try
that
and find
bit.
the Easter egg around there.
Oh, okay. I think there's
So,
like the disco
ooh.
ball. Just tell me about it later. I can't be bothered to go back and look for it just yet. But yeah, and other than that, I've been playing a lot of Twilight Princess HD recently, like a good amount.
Oh yeah, I played a bit more of that.
I'm about 35 hours in, and I'm just about at Hyrule Castle, which I believe
Oh,
is,
that bit, yeah.
yeah, the last temple, I believe, from the looks of it, at least. And it looks, I've just enjoyed it all the way throughout. There's always been something to like just keep me interested. Just looks. Nothing really gets repetitive. All the dungeons feel unique and whatever, because I feel like with Ocarina of Time, at least, I just felt like a bit, not necessarily generic, but especially as Adult Link, you've just got like, oh, you got the Wind Temple, no, the Spirit Temple, wasn't it? The first one as Adult Link, I can't remember. No, Forest Temple,
Oh,
sorry.
and in Ocarina, yeah,
Yeah.
forest, yeah.
Yeah, forest, and then you've got the fire temple and whatever, but they're basically all temples apart from, I think it's like as Young Link when you're going like inside the tree and stuff like that. But so I like the dungeon, like aesthetically, and just the theme of the dungeons, they're all cool. Like in the ice one where you get the ball and chain, you're inside a mansion. I thought that was pretty cool.
Have you done the mansion level?
As I said, I'm at the final one, which is about the ninth one, I believe.
That is the one I always remember as the mansion
The
level
mansion
for the
one's cool.
boss.
Yeah, with Yetto and
Yeah, the Yeti, yeah.
And Yetta, something like
Was
that.
it? Oh, all right.
Did you get
Yetto
scared
and
at
Yetta.
the jump scare of
No. I was kind of expecting it, but
the
I was like, oh God, like, she does not look like herself. She needs to
I
get
think the
some
first
rest.
time I saw that, I got pretty spooked. We were like, "Whoa!"
It was quite creepy. She's
It was
just
quite
like,
creepy.
so pretty. And then
Oh.
just turns into that great big thing.
Yeah. And then the one
Pretty
after
spooky.
that, the Temple of Time. I really liked the Temple of Time dungeon. That was really cool with the Dominion Rod. So that was
But then
cool.
the rod breaks,
Yeah.
because it loses all its magic. That is good.
I quite like that. If there's one that I didn't really enjoy, it would probably be Lakebed Temple. I didn't really like that all that
See,
much.
I like that one.
No one likes the water temple. It's an awesome temple.
I
Like,
like that one compared to other water temples I've
no. Well, I
played in.
think. Well, no. The one in Skyward Sword, the or at least water-like one, where with the boss
I
in
think
Skyward Sword, where you get to use a giant sword. Basically.
I've never played it.
All right, Sam. Do you know
No,
what I'm?
right.
All right. But basically, that temple in Skyward Sword, that was a good water temple. I can't remember you swimming all that much. I can't remember,
I remember
but.
I did the first I've played the first temp like temple of Skyward Sword, but I think that was literally as far as I got. I just got really bored
Fair
of it really
enough.
quickly. So
But most of the temples in Twilight Princess were really good. All felt unique, and fun for that matter. I love the item variety, because you've got like the basic ones like the bombs and the arrows, but then you could combine the two to make bomb arrows. And then you've got the ball and chain, you've got the Dominion Rod, you've got the spinner. So a lot of really cool items that could only be seen in Twilight Princess.
There's a bit more diversity to their items than previous games.
That's true. So I'm hoping we can see like more diverse items for the upcoming Zelda. But yeah, I'm just loving it throughout. If I had to give it as an early review score, maybe a 10 out of 10, maybe.
Oh.
I don't know. Like if I was, I don't know. I'm just loving it. But some things are like, what's going on? Because like the light, just the graphics, I feel that's a bit underwhelming. Like it's a good looking game. But for something that's supposed to be like a HD remaster, you know, I feel they.
I did slightly pick on that.
Like,
I
when you look
think
at.
when you're in Twilight, you can sort of notice the HD difference, but when you're in the normal world, I just don't really
I
notice
think
much
it kind
difference at
of
all.
almost it brings it down a little, because like I noticed like with some of the trees and things, it's still a frame, and then they've applied a graphic to it, and it's like, oh, okay.
It's just like, I don't think the frame rate is 60. I don't know. I think it's 30. I didn't really notice it, to be fair, that it isn't 60. But, you know, that's just a technical thing. It's nothing that I really care about. But just some of the stuff with the shadows, they seem a bit goofy sometimes. I don't know. But yeah, it's just. But it's good. It's
I
good.
think gameplay wise, it's a really good game.
I think it's like. It's probably like my second favorite Zelda, behind
I
Skyward
still
Sword.
think personally that Wind Waker is better, but I, you know, it's only an
The
opinion.
only thing that I didn't like about the Wind Waker though was that I didn't know where to go after the Tower of Gods, because that's just like,
That's 'cause you're rubbish at games.
well, not necessarily like, but like when I was playing that again in the Hero Mode, this is Wind Waker. When I was playing that again in Hero Mode. When I knew what to do, I was enjoying the game far more then.
I think Zelda does have that sort of problem throughout its games, though. It's sort of it tells you what you've got to do, but doesn't tell you how to do it.
Well, some stuff like is okay, but when I just exit the temple and it's like, oh, like here's what you need to do to get the items to get to these temples. That stuff I'm fine with, but it's just like, how can I even get the how can I even access the temples? Oh, you have to encounter that one guy that you probably have seen only one time before. The wind god or whatever, and shoot him down with your arrows. Like, how would I be. Like, I may have missed something, like. But I think I remember talking to, like, practically everyone in Windfall Island and not finding anything. I don't know, but. I just found like it to be a bit stupid, and then the Triforce quest as well was a bit annoying, but it's fine. Wind Waker's still good. I liked Wind Waker. I like most of them. Majora's Mask is probably my least favorite 3D Zelda,
I
to be
don't
honest.
mind Majora's Mask, but yeah, I can understand why.
I don't
It,
mind it.
it's.
It's just like annoying.
I find it too depressing, and I hate the fact that it's like you do stuff and then it all goes away after 3 days, you gotta do it all again.
I
It's
kind
got
of.
some clever concepts in that game. There's a lot of things that they've used in future games from it as well, but it's just. I can sort of understand frustration with that one, definitely, but.
But.
Especially when you, I think the main ones are like when you've got like the one, say you finish one of the dungeons, you've got to collect a certain item, give it to a certain person, then you find out you're supposed to give that to the person on the first day, not the third day, and then you've got to go back again and do it all over again. Yeah, it's a little bit frustrating, but I think that's part of the game, just to make it frustratingly good and difficult. So I don't mind a challenge.
Yeah, I don't mind a challenge, but I just don't like being lost. That's the thing. Because I feel that when you're lost, but have like no actual clue where to go. Because if they don't directly tell you, but yet you know like what to do, Like, well, at least have
That's
an
why you've got the
idea.
helpers, though, to sort of talk to them, and they'll give you a slight hint to where to go. So,
That's true.
anyway, we've been talking too much Zelda. Let's talk more in the discussion.
But other than that, that's all I've been playing, really. I need to finish up the last case, or at least start the last case in Justice for All on Phoenix Wright, which I'll probably do after my exams. So, Sam, what have you been playing?
You've already covered it, which is Twilight Princess.
Alright.
I'm slowly getting through it, and like my own personal playthrough, I finished it because I know the game in and out, and I love it a bit. So, I finished it personally. For the video, I'm up to Death Mountain. So, yeah, I'm halfway through the dungeon, which is fun.
I really liked the Goron Mines as well. That's a really good
Yeah,
dungeon.
there's one bit I absolutely don't like in there, which is you're on the ceiling and you have the iron boots
Oh,
on, but it's such a trudge to go round that
yeah.
maze. I can't roll, I can't do anything. It's just like, and if you go down the wrong way, if you're not paying attention to the map, it's just like, oh, crud. Now I've got to go
Yeah.
back, and then you've got to go that way. But other than that, yeah, I do agree. It's a good dungeon, and the big key isn't. A big key, it's three parts to a key, which is you have to get from the elders, which is really interesting. You get a bit more of the story of what happened. Other than that, that's where I'm up to with Zelda. I'm uncovering more because we've already talked a lot about it. I've been carrying on with Wario Land, the Shake Dimension.
All
I
right.
think we're at area three now.
Yeah, I think
Yes,
so.
area three, which is quite fun. I keep missing so much stuff. I'm
Yeah.
like, oh, I want to show as much as I can, but then you've got to run. You saved the little fairy thing, and you've got a bloody run. And I'm like, sugar, cool, like everything's coming at you, and you're trying not to miss the missions as well as get the treasure. It's like, damn it. I think at one point I panicked because it was like a pipe or you'd fall down. And I was like, which one do I go down? But it's
Oh.
such a good game. It's a little different take on some of the Wario Land games, so I still recommend it greatly for and like Jack picked up on, it's quite cartoony almost, isn't it?
Yeah.
It
But it does look
animated.
good. And then what? Oh no, there's something me and Jack need to tell everybody about, don't
Yes.
we? We recently Runbow released some new stuff for their game, like stuff that was just added automatically, and then there are other bits they've added to it. But me and Jack had a few goes at it, and Jack got to be his favorite character in the whole world.
I
wouldn't say whole world, but yeah, I got to be lilac.
Trust me, we go back to other episodes. You go on about Freedom Planet a lot,
That's
so
true.
I do, because it's such a good game.
there you go.
Oh.
I had someone complain at me this week because it's too much like Sonic in it.
That's probably what it is, though.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, let's see Sonic do punches and kicks and cyclone jumps and stuff.
They're
Then
probably just
I'll say
annoying,
it's a
just
Sonic
say.
game. But anyway, yeah, we had a good few goes at that, and it was funny as anything. I think we a good chuckle on that.
You can
It's
check out the
thrown in a few.
video on our page right now on NPodcast Systems Facebook and Twitter page. So go have a look. Go have a look. You'll find it.
Yeah, that was good fun. A few of the elements threw us off, didn't it? Some of the newer things that they've added.
Yeah, there's like a one of, like an anti-gravity thing that turns you upside down, and there's like a space one which slows gravity altogether. And
And
it's
then
just...
there was one, there was like anti-gravity pads where it pushes you up as
Yeah.
well.
Yeah. So
But
very
that was
confusing.
weird.
And bubbles.
Yeah, that was weird.
Oh.
But yeah, really good. We like Rumble, so it's
Rumble.
Rumble on the Rumble.
Oh my God.
Rumble, rumble. Oh dear. And other than that, I did like Jack did. I caved into Pokemon Picross and I bought some Picrites. I
Oh.
wanted to get further. It's such a drag to have to be like, I get up, I go in, I do the training. Nope, I still don't have enough to get to the next level. So I was like, do you know what? Sod it. I'm
Well,
gonna
so
just get some
I worked
Picrites.
it out yesterday because some of the later levels you need like 280, 300 Picrites to unlock the next door to go through. So
Right, awesome.
if you've been getting 13 a day, that's gonna be like what 20, 24 days until you can unlock the door just from playing the training
That's
levels. So it's kind of frustrating, really, and you can understand why people like buy Picrites on it. It's just annoying.
I think it's one of those games that if they're not careful, they're going to lose people very quickly.
That's true.
Unless you earn them from some of the levels and like go
Especially when you
back and
can
get them.
go and play the Zelda free one once you download it
Well, it's
from
not
the Mito.
technically free, but
Well, using the Mitomo silver coins, so.
Platinum, actually, just saying.
Oh, Platinum, I'm sorry.
Oh,
platinum, actually. Oh,
Any more games,
Matt's a
Sam?
platinum girl. So
Oh dear. Oh dear.
we all had the title of being a material girl, so.
Oh dear. No, I think that's pretty much most things across. Other than that, I've played a little bit of Smash Run on 3DS because
All
I
right.
just miss playing that. It's so much fun, especially with Bayonetta. Bayonetta is awesome. She just kicks butt.
Yeah.
But that's what I've been playing.
All right.
Yay.
It's been that's still a future one for like by the time June rolls around.
What are we going to play next?
Well, I'll probably be playing Fire Emblem Fates during the half term when I'm away in Ireland. Either that or revising for maths. That won't be for about another 2 weeks. But up until the end of May, probably need to get my head sound, so that's why I can't come on the podcast, sadly. But yeah, are you two looking forward to anything in the coming weeks?
Assume we've got a few more games to play on the bundle. I've got Wind Waker to play. I'll pick that up, pretty cheap.
How far are
I
you though?
might. I've not even started
I
it,
haven't
Wind
even
Waker yet.
started. All right.
Haven't even started because I'm still playing through Twilight Princess, so I want to sort
Okay,
of try and finish
fair
that
enough.
before I start Wind Waker. So, yeah. Don't know if Sam's got anything to play on this next list.
There's too much to mention. I just can't decide. I need to finish other bits and pieces that I've picked up and then never picked up again.
I need to get
I'm
back to playing
still.
Xenoblade.
See, there's just too many games. Too
There
many
is.
games.
I need to finish the Chroma League on Blooming
Really?
Pokemon. I got there and I was just like, yeah, I kind of got like, oh, but then I got to fight through five more people and they get frustrating and I'm like,
Yeah.
oh.
We need to play a Pokken like someday. Like we need to do versus.
I'm used to say it.
Anyway, so with that, let's move on to our next section. So this is the discussion portion of the podcast now, and we are talking about the big news, the big cheese, from Nintendo's latest investor meeting, which is their annual investor meeting. This is big because there are three main topics to cover here. The first of all being that
Cheddar, Gorgonzola,
that's not Gouda.
and blue
And
cheese.
Wensleydale.
Sorry,
Dear, oh
we
dear.
were saying about cheese and I got carried
Well,
away.
yeah, it's an expression. But the first piece of news is that we actually get proper information regarding the Nintendo NX, which is going to be the next generation of gaming, and it'll be launching in March of 2017. So it's under a year, but we all thought that would be coming out before the end of 2016, during the holiday period this year. Kimishima has said that the main reason they've held back until March 2017 is because they weren't ready. I think he said that they need the games, which is fair enough. That's alright. So that's the reason why it's coming in March 2017 and not the end of 2016. And I feel that they've done a good job of saying don't hold back until the end of 2017, because that's too far away, I feel like. But yeah, what do you guys think about it coming out in March
2017? I wasn't really surprised it was delayed, to be honest, because we still haven't heard anything about what it is. So
yeah.
It's still really dark and really quiet. It's just, you would have expected at least something to have dropped by now in terms of hardware or anything. There's been lots of rumours saying that it's going to be equal to PlayStation in terms of hardware, but then that was cancelled out by someone else saying it wasn't, and there's just been nothing official said about it still. It's like, it's ridiculous.
It is. I think though it's a smart move for them to probably push it back, because if it's not polished or if it's not ready, they're going to end up with the same situation they had with Wii U, and it was rushed. It was too quick. It was too. There wasn't enough time for it to be perfected completely.
That's what I'm thankful for them saying we're going to skip the holiday period, even though it may mean better sales. We still want a strong console to start us off with, which I think.
Well, we say better sales, but you look at Wii U; it struggled.
Well, yeah, it struggled, but it
they
may have done
during a prime period.
But it may have struggled even more if it launched at the start of 2013. You know. With the same stuff.
2013. Oh,
Yeah, it would have been. I'm thankful that they've said that it's going to be in March of 2017, as opposed to the end of 2016.
It just seems very odd all round, though, doesn't it? How they've done it in March. It's not really known for a date to be releasing consoles.
Exactly, so that's the big problem.
If they're just trying something different, to maybe try different parts of the market. I know in terms of game sales, the spring's been pretty decent for Nintendo in the last couple of years, but that's because of games like Majora and Monster Hunter coming out for 3DS. So can you really compare that? I don't really know.
Exactly, so that's the problem.
The thing that I was sort of thought about when it first sort of come through is when the Christmas period goes, there's normally a couple of months people take to pay off everything that's happened over Christmas in terms of actual like dinner and paying for presents and things, because of credit card bills and stuff like that. It normally comes to about March by the time people have got enough money to spend again. So maybe it is quite a clever idea, the fact that they've
kind of
gone, here you go, March, here's the console, boom, here it is.
And letting people know this far in advance kind of gives them at least a chance to kind of like even get some sort of financial savings behind them for it if they wanted to.
I'm going to say this. I think it will be on the 24th. Wait, no. Either the 24th or the 23rd, depending on where, or when, rather, Good Friday falls on. Because
that is true.
It's the week before March ends. March ends on Friday the 31st. Hold on, I'll check. Good Friday.
I just looked at it though, and I've gone back on some of Nintendo's older consoles. For instance, like the NES was released October 85. The earliest the console's ever been released by them was June, when the Game Boy was released in 89. Everything else is normally in October or August, so it's very strange indeed. But
Good Friday falls on the 14th, actually.
April 14th, yeah. Which is so weird, I think. But so I think it'll be the 24th then of March, I feel. Either that or the 31st.
The Game Boy Advance SP was released in March.
Well,
there you go.
Well, the 3DS
bit of knowledge
was
for you.
As well, but remember that they're handhelds. This is a console. Consoles are much bigger over here, not as much in Japan. Handhelds are much bigger in Japan compared to consoles over there, but over here in Western audiences, consoles are much bigger because people have got phones, so the handheld market is, I wouldn't say dwindling, but slowly declining in importance, I feel like.
Yeah.
So, to release it in March, it's a bit of a weird move, I feel like.
It's a risk, but
it's
it
a
could
risk.
Pay off. It could,
hopefully,
it could not. But
hopefully people will realise, oh, there's still really good stuff on the
NX.
It may be
another battle plan, though, saying they can't get enough games out for it again. If they've got just Zelda on it at the time, and maybe a couple of other indie games and things on there, maybe they're sort of planning it for when Christmas does come around. Hopefully by then they'll have another load of games to
That's
add
true.
To the library, so they make it a bit more convincing to buy by Christmas.
Maybe. But then again, that's like a whole 9 months. Really,
yeah,
almost.
True.
So
can they last that long?
Well,
with dwindling sales?
I think they're gonna have like a really strong launch. They've learned their mistakes from the Wii U, and judging by Kimishima's statement, I think they're gonna be having a strong first party lineup.
It's been a history though with most launches. To be fair, it's if you look back as far as the 64 had only three games, maybe two games in America on launch. DS, the 3DS only had Zelda and Star Fox when it first came out.
Well, that was in the launch like year, but not the actual launch
those
day.
Those were the only two games on launch day.
No, it was there was Pilot Wings and Nintendogs plus Cats, but Ocarina didn't come out. Sorry. But I don't think Ocarina of Time came out until July, and Star Fox 64 3D didn't come out until September of that year.
Sure.
So, but they were still launch periods, so they may have contributed, but
yeah,
still not entirely sure.
It's not the first time that they've had a poor launch list. I mean, they're
Fair
quite
enough.
Often with Nintendo consoles, there's only a few games on launch. It's not like there's going to be like 25 games available to buy straight away.
That's true.
It's not going to happen.
Yeah. But I think,
especially with the way they plan it out throughout the year, especially with what they've done with the Wii U lately.
That's true. But actually, on the topic of that, their Christmas like is all down to Pokemon now, really. Because I think Paper Mario isn't coming out until the summer, and even if that comes out around the holiday, that's not gonna be good, because that's not like a hard hitting title like previous years like Mario 3D World or Smash Bros. So, anyway, let's move on to our next piece of news for the discussion. It was revealed that Zelda, the new Zelda title, will be coming to both NX and Wii U. So it's receiving the Twilight Princess treatment. Practically most of us expected it, really. What are your guys' take on this?
On the delay, or...?
Yeah, on the delay. Well, actually, yeah. Because it was also announced that Zelda will be coming to Wii U and NX, as I just stated, but now it's also coming to 2017.
They've delayed it till the March 2017 NX release date.
Well, they just said 2017, but for a little while, it did say on their on the press site for the new Zelda, it did briefly say March 2017 before being changed to just 2017.
Oh, okay.
I think March is very likely, because I feel like in my opinion, I think the Zelda Wii U should have kept on track for the holiday of this year. And then the NX being improved.
That could kill sales, though.
Yeah, that's the turnaround of it, really. But I think it's just the fact that, like, now it's more or less confirmed that it's going to be a launch title. Because, hold on, I'm trying to get my words together, like, my reasoning. But it's just, like, a very strong feeling that's just, like, this is definitely going to be a launch title.
Because, so they're releasing both for the Wii U and the NX for the next Zelda game. Yeah. It's basically
because
what they're saying.
Because I feel like it would have been done by Christmas of 2016. I feel that the reassurance of saying, oh, this is definitely coming out in 2016. I'm just going to be oblivious here. But I really do think they would have been able to make it for 2016. And that the only reason they've now delayed it until March 2017... so that it could be on the NX and be on the NX for its launch date. Not in the launch period, on the launch day. So that's my reasoning behind it, to be honest.
My only thought is, have they hit a problem? Is this something that they're not telling us that's causing them to then have to put it back as well?
I think it's just like what Jack said, with saying that it will be a hindrance to the NX sales, so that's why they have to release it at the same time.
There's no point releasing the new Zelda game for the Wii U in November, December, if you're going to release it in March for the NX, because if people have already played it and completed it on the Wii U, why would they want to buy it at the NX, is the main point. I mean, I just looked at the release dates for Twilight Princess, and there was literally, it was released the same day in Japan, but there was a month away everywhere else. So it's, you know, within the same sort of period, you could always pick up a Wii to play it on the Wii if you really wanted to. So it's having that option closer by. I mean, if it's 5 months away difference or 3 months away, maybe that's a bit too far. Because that would hinder sales quite a lot, I'd feel.
I just, the only thing I think is this, either there's something wrong that they're having trouble with, and it's they've had to sort of not sort of say anything, and they've just said, right, we're going to put it back. Because, like, you look at, like, we're saying, like, oh, it'll be good for the Christmas period and blah, blah, blah. But you look at things like, and I don't mean to compare it to this, but, like, Sonic Boom, where they rushed it, got it out, and then it went horribly, horribly wrong. So it's more of a Sonic blunder than a Sonic Boom.
Sam
went there.
Well, they patched that out with, like, a 1 gigabyte patch, just saying, and improved, like, a lot of the problems.
1 gigabyte, though.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
A big patch. That's a big problem. And for that to happen to a very core franchise of Nintendo, of Zelda, do you know what I mean? That's not going to create a good impression. And that, I think that's, like, I wonder if they're holding it back because they don't want something like that to happen to such a good... a good part of Nintendo. I would hope that that's possibly a reason why. But it's getting other people to understand that, and, well, obviously you look at Sonic Boom, and then Sonic's reputation is just not good, not as good as what it was.
Can you imagine if they had, like, a Sonic game for the launch of the NX? Can you imagine?
I don't think it would sell very well.
What do you mean? Well, like, no, if they went to, like, proper Sonic, like, say, Sonic Generations Sonic.
Do you mean, like, Freedom Planet?
Yeah, like, Freedom Planet, Sonic Colors, like, the actually good Sonic games. If they had a game like that, one of the biggest biggest icons in gaming on their new system, I think that could be very good for them. But I don't know. It may happen. I wouldn't mind it to happen. But I think, and we were talking about on the last show about the rumors discussing of the ports of of games like Smash Bros. And Splatoon, I wouldn't mind them being like a launch games because Smash 4 and Splatoon are two of my favourite games of all time, to be honest. Definitely my top three. Those two. So, if I see them on this new console, I definitely want to be able to get them. Play their improved versions and whatnot. So, yeah, but just the fact that like Zelda is being delayed again, I think it's just for the purpose so they could cross-release it for the NX, not because they've been delayed and like actually fixing stuff. I feel like, I think it's just the fact with like other games need to more time to be worked on and stuff like that. Because Zelda, as monumental as it is in the gaming industry, if they just release the NX with just Zelda and a port of it, no less, that's just going to be a bit iffy, I guess is the word. I don't know, but you get what I mean, hopefully. Yeah, and then just and the last big shocker here is regarding E3. We are coming up to that season. It's only just over a month away. It's one of the like the most exciting times of the year, isn't it, for like gaming fans, because you're gonna see a whole bunch of new games. I don't know what's so special about it, because even though we can probably get the same stuff during the Nintendo Direct, just the fact that it's at E3 just makes it a whole lot more special. Nintendo are going a different route this year, so E3, despite being one of the biggest gaming conventions, no, it's actually the biggest gaming event of the year. The only game that will be playable on the show floor will be the new Zelda, and they won't be displaying the Nintendo NX either. And the Nintendo NX will be displayed later on in the year. There's no word yet what other things they're planning to do. We don't know if they're gonna do another digital event. That still announces new games, but then again, people won't be able to play those games at the show floor. We don't know if there's going to be another World Championships. I hope so, but we don't know anything about that other than the fact that Zelda will be the only game playable on the show floor for attendees at E3. And I think, judging by the fact that the NX won't be there, it will only be on the Wii U version. So yeah, it's kind of tragic because even though I don't go there and I'm dying to see new Zelda footage and a good amount at that, just completely removing it and just so they could focus on Zelda is a bit risky, very risky. Not enough for a biscuit, just like. Was too risky for a biscuit, let's say. Because even though, like, hold on, I'll get up the email, but basically they said Nintendo always plans to change things up for E3. We certainly saw that with last year because it wasn't well received, frankly. Hold on, let me see here. Okay, here we go. Nintendo changes its approach to the show every year. This June, Nintendo will focus its attention the upcoming game in the Legend of Zelda franchise. The Wii U version of the game will be playable for the first time on the E3 show floor, and it will be the only game playable Nintendo presents at the show. In order to provide attendees a complete immersion, additional information about Nintendo's E3 plans will be announced in the future. So,
So that sounds to me that there's going to be a massive direct telling you everything's going to happen, and that's about
I think,
it.
like, because I hope that they do the digital event and just basically make it an E3 direct, so they reveal new games coming up and all that, like last year. That's all I want, really, to be fair. Like, if they don't do that, then it's just like that was a terrible, well, not a terrible E3, but the whole aspect of the immersion of Zelda, they've gotta like bleeding deck it out with all Zelda decorations and stuff like that. They've got to make it feel like the attendees are being in Hyrule themselves. Because if they don't do that and it's just like, oh, Zelda's practically everywhere, that's a bit. I don't know. Zelda's a popular
All I
type.
can say so far is it's the only game confirmed at the moment. It doesn't say that there's going
Well,
to be that is the only one game.
no, they've just said it, like, the only game playable. But hopefully, they'll be lying, though. Hopefully,
So
I can
maybe there'll be
dream.
lots of demos visually of other games rather than
Maybe.
actual playable
Or,
demos,
like,
but
at Treehouse Live.
Treehouse stuff, yeah.
Hopefully. But, what Fudge's Space was saying on his discussion with, Josh Thomas was that, he suggested that some games that were announced in the digital event would be available to play, but only for the media. So that would be behind closed doors, stuff like
Yeah.
that. Which would be good because I don't know, it's just very risky having an E3 with only one game playable, no matter how big or how much of a crowd pleaser it may be. You know. And to be fair, we don't.
Two years ago, Splatoon was the only game playable.
What? No. There was.
It,
No, like,
yeah.
Splatoon had, like, a big part, but there are other games playable, like, there was
Yep,
Smash.
go on,
Oh,
they went,
no, but I know
Smash.
that there's more. Like, there was Smash, there was Hyrule Warriors. Hold on, I'll get up the list, hold on. Just short of
I'm
VGTribune,
quite
sorry.
confident that
No.
Splatoon was pretty much the main game there that they had to play, and that was pretty much it. There might have been a
It
couple of
was a
hand-on
big
demos,
one,
but
but it wasn't the central one.
I don't think I'd be that worried, to be honest, because Nintendo, in terms of the big festivals and things like E3, they've really removed themselves from it in the last couple of years anyway. Because of the things like the Nintendo Directs, they've done their own ideas and how they display things, how they show it off to the public. I honestly am not that worried about E3 at all. It's interesting that Nintendo have come out and said that they're not going to be showing much there, but I think a few other companies have said the same. I think Square Enix was one of the ones that said they're not really going to show that much off at E3. I presume there was a few others, but I can't think of them at the top of my head at the moment. It's, I think there's been some sort of issue with the organisation of E3 this year. But yeah, we have to wait and see, really, won't we? It's with that one.
But so this is the first time though with just one title, so I'm a bit hesitant really.
But then there are another hundreds of different shows they could easily display consoles and games at. E3 is one of the biggest ones in America, but there are bigger ones in Japan and the
Well, I
UK as
don't think they're
well,
like.
so
Well, there aren't any bigger ones. Like, E3 is the biggest. No matter how way you look at it, I
the
feel like.
biggest is North America, yeah.
Well, yeah, no, but in the world, though. Like, everybody's excited about that. Nobody really gives a toss about, like, EGX or stuff like that. And EGX is the biggest one in the UK. So.
Eurogamer?
Well, yeah, so that's EGX.
Well, not the other Eurogame in Germany.
Oh, Gamescom.
Gamescom, that's it.
Gamescom is quite big. So yeah,
That's
they could possibly do a Gamescom announcement there for the NX, maybe.
Japan do have a lot of tech shows. They do.
Maybe.
Over there, they could. It's a lot easier for them to display in Japan. So.
But I feel
Yeah,
like
quite a few for 2014's E3. I'm just looking through now.
What do they have?
They had Art Academy, Bayonetta 2, Captain Toad Treasure Tracker, Codename Steam, Devil's Third.
Codename Steam was like at the round table, I think. It wasn't playable, I don't
Yeah.
think.
Hyrule. Oh, there were Hyrule Warriors,
Mario
Kirby and the
Party.
Rainbow Curse.
Yeah, that was there.
Mario Party 10, yeah.
And Mario Maker as well.
Fair enough.
Yep, so you're wrong, Jack.
Oh.
Like, whenever something doesn't agree with me, I go to no ends to disapprove them. I'm just saying. I'm such a dick. Sorry.
I was just more interested, but there you
No,
go.
I'm just like, no, I'm proving you wrong. Oh, but
I'm not bothered.
oh, I don't know why I get so heated up. I think I get it from my mum, I think. I don't know.
Oh.
I don't
Sorry,
know.
Mum.
Like, it's in my family to be like overly competitive, I think.
Oh. Is that journalist coming out of you?
Probably,
Yeah.
yeah. Oh crap, I lost. Oh, we were just talking about like other events, weren't we?
Zelda NX and stuff, and E3 and stuff.
Well, I think Roger Space also said that they could bring like a Space World event though as well.
They could do their own event.
Yeah,
They
so
could quite
that's
easily do it.
is that
Yeah.
some Nintendo Space World? Space World, yeah, or at least Nintendo and Space World. I can't remember if Space World was their own event or if it was an event that they went
I
to,
think it
but
was a joint event, but it
I
was
think
quite
so.
heavily Nintendo based, so.
I think so.
They should do Super Mario Galaxy through an Oculus Rift.
Let's not, shall we?
Oh, that would be so weird.
That'd be so weird.
Jumping on doing
I
wall
don't know.
jumps and stuff.
Yeah, so at Space World in 2000, I've just looked on Google and it's all like the GameCube tech demo of Zelda. Remember when they just did like a quick little trailer of the news of a Zelda demo to show like the GameCube's graphics and stuff. But yeah, so they could certainly just host their own Space World event saying, "This is DNX, these are the games, look forward to it." And I think in some ways that would be better because at E3, because there's been rumours of the PlayStation 4 Neo, which is basically like basically a mid-generation new PS4 with like upgraded frame rate and stuff like that. So Sony may announce that, and that may take away the thunder from the Nintendo NX. I hope it doesn't, and I think it shouldn't, because a brand new console should take away all the attention from an upgrade of a system. But you never know in today's world, sadly. So if they have their own event, they could have all the focus on them. And they could just make the announcement, and everybody will be focused. It won't be in the heat of all the E3 stuff. So from their point, from that point, that's all right. But I just feel the fact like not much info regarding the NX will be present at E3. So.
I think the idea of a space world could be quite a promising one. I mean, especially when you look back at most of the ones they've done are for console releases. I mean, the last one they had was called Nintendo World in 2011 in Tokyo, and that was for the release of the 3DS.
Oh, was it?
That's
All right.
in Tokyo on January 8th, 2011. So.
All right. Oh, well, that wouldn't mean for the reveal, would it have been? Like, they. But then again, that was his own little event, wasn't it? So.
Well, they did previous ones for the Wii, for the Game Boy Advance, for the GameCube. It was one of the biggest ones, if you remember, the Space World demos. There, they
All right.
showed off loads of gameplay and videos.
Yeah,
And
so.
the Super Mario 128 was one of the most famous ones they showed off there. So they could
Yeah.
always do their own one again for that and show off
Well, it
a
depends on
load of other
like
games.
it depends on the time of this event, because if they do it too late in the year, I think they should do it like about maybe late July, sometime in August. I think that's the best time to do their own event to announce the NX, because it won't be too long waiting. Because if they leave it until like October or something, that's not a lot of time, I feel like.
No.
So I think their best option is to do it sometime in the summer.
Yeah, they need to whet people's appetite.
Definitely.
I'm hoping by the time it gets to. Anyway, we should know the full details of the NX or whatever they call
Oh
it
yeah,
when it's
totally.
released. So it's just that with this frustrating port period that they send, they've got it they got all plans for it, but they haven't told anyone about it yet.
Yeah.
And it's like, we need to know what it is before we decide we want to buy it or not. And it's
Yeah.
we need some time.
Like, it's kind of exciting, but then again, it's not, because.
I still think they'll announce it in a direct at during E3, personally, but.
Nah, I don't think so. That's just underwhelming in my opinion. It was an upgrade, like the new Nintendo 3DS was revealed, or the 3DS XL. That's fine, but for bringing in a whole new generation, I feel like
Well,
announcing it.
Mr. Iwata already announced the Wii. Just put it out, pulled out of his pocket, and go,
Yeah,
there you go,
but then
here it
again,
is.
like that was at an actual conference, like an actual event. I feel like if they just did it during a direct with not an actual audience there, I feel that's a bit underwhelming. But who knows? We may be seeing them going back on this. I hope, to be honest, I hope that they don't take these plans back and rearrange it in some ways, because it's like they go ahead. Well, they seem to be going ahead with this plan, and I want to see it brought out to fruition, if you get what I mean. Like, I'd rather it be like full, like showing off the NX for the first time, all these brand new games and whatnot. But now that I've said this, I kind of don't want them to say, you know what, we're just gonna be let the fans decide. Because I feel like that's what I like about Nintendo, that they are. In some ways, it does worry me, to be fair, that they are saying, oh, we do what we want. But then again, that's what I do like about Nintendo. They are doing what they want to do. They do
They're
what they think is
not being
best.
told by anyone else how to
Yeah.
do it. They're just going to go with it and
So I
see
hope that
what
they
happens.
do
So.
bring this plan of not doing anything else. I hope they bring it to full fruition. So that's all I can say.
We'll soon find out.
Hopefully, but now I'm just like I was really looking forward to doing like an E3 prediction special episode. But now it's just like it's just gonna be another
Predict
feature
there'll be
of it.
Zelda.
Oh really? Oh,
Yeah.
but then actually, whilst we're on the topic, just to close out that new concept art of Link, I love it. It's so good.
You love it.
I do. Like it's like my avatar on Skype. You two can see it probably. It's now my avatar on Twitter as well. It's just a really cool piece of concept art, I feel like. That's all I'm gonna say.
Cool.
Can't really say much else.
No, we don't see much else.
No, can't wait to see more. That's all I can
Can't
say.
wait. I can't wait until we just get that big blowout of Zelda news. That's all I'm saying. Anyway, and so with that, I think that wraps up for this section. So let's move on to our final section. So this is the final section of the podcast now, or otherwise known as our shout out section. Jack, do you want to start us off?
Yep, I've got a few shout outs. One for Street Pass Bays in Stoke for putting on a really good event for mainly for Pokken. There's a bit of Star Fox there, and we played a bit of Monster Hunter and things like that. It's a really good event. There's quite a few people turned up actually. I think it's about 30, 40 in the end, so
All right.
pretty good for them. A shout out for Ant from Street Pass Bays in Stoke. He was on the podcast previously. He's been doing some videos for Family Gamer TV, and he's recently been reviewing Yo-Kai Watch. He's really enjoying it, and he was actually featured on Nintendo Life this week for mentioning Yo-Kai Watch. So if you get a
That's right.
chance, have a look on there, and you might be able to, I might be able to find him on there on a little video. So.
All right.
So cheers, Anne, and I'm sure we'll carry on watching your stuff. I also have one other shout out this week for Troj Thompson. I don't know if that's how you say your first name. Sorry if that's wrong. He's from the Monster Hunter Essex group, and he's been talking to me over Facebook the last couple of weeks, and he's saying he really enjoys the podcast
On the
and
way.
he listens to it quite a lot. And I was like, "Oh, thanks, dude. That's really nice of you," and things. So, it's really weird. I'm still getting people on Miitomo saying the same thing as well, saying that, like, "Thanks for doing the podcast," and what else do I do other than the podcast?
Oh.
Nothing, apparently. So, yeah, cheers, everyone who's on there.
Thank
Thanks,
you.
Charles, for your kind words. Very nice of you. Yeah, other than that, I've got no more shout-outs. So.
All right. I don't think I have any shout-outs, to be honest. Let me think.
Sure, you got one.
I should. I just don't like.
Should we give a mini shout out to Stealth or?
Oh yeah, like mini shout Stealth. I won't put it out, but he was supposed to be coming on. He should be coming on soon. In our next episode probably, but we shall see. Oh, actually, yeah. Shout outs to Street Pass London's upcoming event in July. Basically, they're going to be outside again like last year, and it may take me an eternity to find the place again. Hopefully not, but should be nice. Hopefully it'll be sunny, and hopefully we'll go down to the pub eventually later on as well, like
Are
we did
you old
last year.
enough?
I just got a J2O, like I'm fine with that.
Yeah,
And then also
this podcast was sponsored by J2O.
and DS London as well. They're I wasn't able to go to their event recently on Saturday, but I may be able to go to theirs on May 28th at MCM London.
Ooh.
So yeah, maybe.
Maybe.
So if I had to pick, those were probably my two shout-outs.
Maybe.
Maybe. So Sam, we just finish off with you. Any shout-outs?
Have one in particular. It's the same again to my friend, Ben, also known as Nebjinim on YouTube. He's sadly finished his temporary placement at work, and he's had to head back up north now, which I'm really
Oh.
sad about. So I just want to wish him luck and all that. And obviously for everybody, go check out his channel, Nebjanim, which I'm sure Matt will chuck in the link descriptions again. He's doing Witcher 300% playthrough, so please go check out his channel.
You should tell them to play Nintendo
Yeah, I should.
stuff.
He just watches my stuff, to be honest. So I'm
That's
like,
cool.
fine,
That's cool.
that's cool.
Everyone should go watch our Rumbo video because it's amazing.
Yeah, please. If you know, it was good fun. Hopefully, we'll have another one or two up at some point. It was just great to do to see some new bits in Rumbo.
Like Matt said, there might be a little bit of a hiatus in the next couple of weeks due to he's got lots of exams and
Exams.
stuff on,
Oh,
so.
actually, just shout outs to anybody taking exams.
Yeah,
There we go.
they
can
good luck
be,
everyone.
yeah,
Don't panic, you'll be all right.
yeah.
Worst comes to worst, just like sit around and play video games all day. I'm joking. Study, pass, get good
I need to
grades, get a
study.
good
Make
job.
sure when you have to read your questions.
Oh yeah, read your questions. That's a big one.
Yeah, look for the key thing they're asking for. Never,
Exactly.
ever just rush it.
Just think, if you do well on those, you could get a good job, which means you could buy more Nintendo games. There you
Sure. I think that's it for the shout-outs, but that's not it for this section. However, we have two stuff in the works. First of all, giveaways. We don't know how long these are gonna last, but basically, with the Humble Bundle, me and Jack, we both have games that we already have or simply do not want. So I think it's on Twitter, isn't it, that we're going to be handing these out?
Yeah, either Twitter or Facebook,
Yeah, one or the other. At least on Twitter, we may sort out Facebook details in a bit. But what will happen is on Twitter, just follow us at N Podcast System, and we tweet the tweet on the game that you want. So we'll be tweeting the games. For example, on
I
my
mean, Freedom Planet's gonna be one of them in the, on
Yep.
there, I'm sure.
We have one code for
Yep.
that. Shantae and the Pirate's Curse for both Wii U and 3DS, there with that. We have two codes for Darksiders 2. Just basically check out our Twitter, follow us on there, and we tweet the tweets for the games that you want. And then, probably about a week or so, you may win those games. So that's our first important thing. Our second thing, quite big, or at least for my own eyes, at least. For a while now, we have been talking amongst ourselves for new artwork for the show. Because as it is now, even though I quite like the current artwork, I've always felt that it hasn't really defined us as a show. I don't really see this as a business either, but I feel like we could be something more than just Mario
We
characters.
would like it to be something more unique
Yeah,
and that it
that's
stands out and really gives the show the
identity.
extra touch.
Yeah, the extra touch.
Professionalism.
Yeah. So what we've so the artwork we're planning on doing is similar to Nintendo Dads, and just to give a quick preview, we'll like how Nintendo Dads, the three of them are dressed up as Mario, Donkey Kong, and Tingle. We're gonna be in costumes of Fox. Jack will be in a Fox outfit. Sam will be in a Lucario-themed outfit, and I'll be either dressed as an Inkling or Link, one or the other. The artwork will be done by Adam of the Mega Dads podcast, who did a commission work for Nintendo Dads when he went on to Guess. So hopefully you'll do a great job. However, we do need the money. It's not a lot. It's I believe the goal will be £38. And so once we raise that, we'll be able to pay Adam for the money for to do the artwork rather, and hopefully we'll get a really good quality artwork, which will be our new logo, which will be used for Twitter, Facebook, and all that good stuff, I guess. Basically, on Kickstarter, if you pledge £1 or at least a minimum, I'm not sure, you will get a shout out in the next episode, and you just gotta like write a little message, I guess. Whatever you want. If you donate, I'm not sure about the pricing, probably about in between £5 to £7, you will be entered into the chance to be on an episode of Nintendo Podcast System. So if you want to be a chance with being a guest on our show, which will include just talking with us, picking the music, maybe picking the topics, and possibly playing with us on Wii U and 3DS. You could be in a chance with that if you donate £5 to £7, somewhere in between there. I'm not sure. Future rewards may be added, but the important thing here is that I'm hoping that we could just work together to bring together this piece of new artwork that will hopefully, I guess, probably unite us all. Like, it will make us feel more of a podcast, more official, I guess. There'll probably be update videos to both of them on our YouTube channel, which is of course Nintendo Podcast System. So yeah, I'm hoping that you could pledge some money towards it. It's not a lot of amount, but it's not a big goal, but I'm hoping that it will be met, and hopefully you guys will like the end product too. So yeah, that practically wraps it up for this episode. I'm gonna have a trouble like deciding on a name. Like, I don't know.
Intend rage.
Nintendo Rage. Well, we haven't really raged that much, have we? Like, I've been more
No.
excited, I feel like. I don't know.
Just stuck in the middle, aren't we? Sort of want to know what's happening with
Just stuck in the
X
middle.
and
Just
want
stuck
to
in the
know what's
middle.
happening with Wii U. And yeah.
Let's go with that. Just stuck in the middle. That's our title.
Yeah.
Anyway,
Cool.
so that wraps up for this episode of Nintendo Podcast System, episode 25. Where can you can find the podcast on Facebook at N Podcast System. Well, it's on iTunes and Podomatic at the same name. Twitter at N Podcast System as well. YouTube, Nintendo Podcast System. Guys, where can they find you?
On the internet.
Oh, really?
At
Dear God.
Gorny7789. That's at Gorny7789 on Twitter. I'm on YouTube. I'm on Facebook. Just look for me. I'll tell you.
Sam, where can they find you?
They can at Sam Spade underscore UK for normal stuff. At Sam Spade Gaming for my YouTube stuff on Twitter. You can find me on YouTube at Sam Spade Gaming, and also on Facebook as well.
And you can find me at VGTribune.com and on Twitter at AceGibbo. Yeah, so that's episode 25. We may not be seeing you for a good while, so I hope you enjoyed this episode of the podcast, and happy gaming.
Catch you later on, dudes.
Bye-bye.
Oh, wait. I forgot this again. Outro music. Do you guys want to decide for me? I'm just drawing a blank, really. I'll let one of you guys decide the ending theme. As
to be on the podcast. Ah.
Let's go with the main theme to Freedom Planet. Why not?
Yes, do that.
So the ending theme is going to be Freedom Planet. Sorry for that. Forgetfulness on my part. So again, I hope you enjoyed listening to episode 25 of Nintendo Podcast System. And happy gaming.